And we start actually one of the last lecture. Indeed, as you realized, up to now we are describing some real hydraulic structures. And first of all, we restart from the last slide of the last lecture. Indeed, if you remember, this is a kind of lateral spillway. We can write here lateral spillway that it is needed to convey a water discharge here in order to satisfy some needings about the water results. But actually, in order to make efficient from an hydraulic point of view this lateral spillway, we need also to deploy other hydraulic structure. As you can imagine, here we have another spillway whose aim is to increase the water depth in this area in order to make more efficient from an hydraulic point of view this lateral spillway. So up to now we need to describe some details about these structures. Indeed, from you can see a kind of sketch of this problem. Indeed, here you have the river, the upstream river. So here you have the water discharge flowing in the main river, and here you have a kind of structure that is aimed to increase the water depth in this area in order to make efficient this lateral spillway. And as you can see here, this is plan view. Of course, I'm referring to the upper part of this slide. As you can see here, we have this structure. So more or less you have a spillway for which in the upstream part, you can have a higher water depth if compared to the case in which the spillway is not deployed along the river. And in the meantime, you can see also the lateral spillway, this one, that is more or less with the same shape. And in this case, if the water depth is increased in this area, then the water depth, then the flow can occur also on the lateral spillway. So this is basically the configuration of such a kind of intervention. And this is just an example. This is a road near Rome. This is the Tiber River, il Tevere. And here you can see this one that is a kind of spillway. And this one, up to now, we don't know. We don't know what this construction is, this building is, but what we can see is that upstream, the Tiber River seems to be very quiet here. As you can see, the water is calm, whilst in the downstream part, it seems that the velocity is higher than the upstream part. So if we call this velocity V1, this one, V2, is higher than V1, at least from a qualitative point of view. But we can also imagine that the water depth here, actually the free surface elevation here, is higher than here. So if we make a kind of section here, we should see a situation like this one. Like this one. So this is the upstream. So this is water depth upstream. And actually here we have the downstream water depth. Just by looking at this picture, here the water depth is higher, then the velocity is lower. Downstream the velocity is higher and then the water depth is lower, just by looking at the picture. And this is a picture taken from upstream. So just to understand, if we take a picture from here, looking downstream, we can see something like that. So this is the spillway. This is the spillway. If you see the water depth here, Y1, or better, Y upstream, is higher than the water depth downstream. So the spillway induces a difference of the water depth. So if we come back here, here we have a difference. I have to bend. Here we have a kind of difference of water depth between the upstream part and the downstream part that you can get here. So here you have a kind of jump. Actually, this is the Tiber River. This is Tiber. This is a technical design of the spillway, so you can realize that these are the piles, and you can see also here, these are the piles. Also here you can see some strange structure. From this sketch you can realize that they are made of metal. And indeed, we can see this one. This is the upper part, of the. So here we have this one, the upper part of this gate. So the name of this part of the structure are called gate, and this is a pile. But also we can look at this part of the building. If you remember, we are talking about this part when we use a question mark. Here you can see that probably here the water depth is upstream, YU. Here we have YD. And here we have three turbines. They are turbines. Actually, they are a kind of machines able to extract energy from the flow thanks to the difference of water depth between the upstream part and the downstream part. So actually, this spillway is aimed to induce a difference of water depth, and this difference of water depth forces the flow through the turbines in order to extract energy. Indeed, if we come back here we have an area in which a series of electrical devices are deployed. So actually this is a power plant that, thanks to the difference of water depth from between the upstream part and the downstream part, is able to extract energy from the flow and then to feed a kind of electrical series of electrical devices. So this is actually a power plant. Just to realize that the speedway can be used to decrease the water discharge flowing along a river. It can be used to convey a part of the water discharge in order to satisfy a needings of water, but also to extract energy, as in this case. Quindi, giusto per descrivere in maniera seppur qualitativa questo caso, questo qua è Fiume Tevere, questa è la centrale di Castel Giubileo. The power plant, the name of the power plant is Castel Giubileo in Roma. Quindi gli sfioratori è vero che possono essere utilizzati per far diminuire la portata nel caso in cui ci sia un problema di inondazione, ad esempio in un centro urbano. È vero che possono essere utilizzati per deviare una porzione della portata liquida per soddisfare un bisogno di acqua, quella che viene chiamata risorsa idrica, ma può essere utilizzato anche per estrarre energia. Quindi, nel momento in cui realizzate uno sfioratore come di questo tipo, in un fiume, create un dislivello e questo dislivello può essere sfruttato per estrarre energia idroelettrica, quindi nell'ambito di una risorsa rinnovabile, se volete. E come vedete, qui c'è un po' la vista da monte e questo è un po' lo schema tecnico della centrale di Castel Giubileo. Quindi vedete, c'è il Tevere, c'è una parte che fa defluire le acque, quindi nel momento in cui il Tevere va in piena vengono rimosse le paratoie, quelle che qui sono chiamate gate, e quindi il deflusso continua più o meno indisturbato, a meno della presenza delle pile, ma quando la portata è compatibile al funzionamento della centrale idroelettrica, l'acqua invece che passare nella parte, diciamo, a destra di questo schema, ma in corrispondenza della sinistra idraulica del fiume Tevere, quindi il deflusso viene impedito in sinistra idraulica e il deflusso avviene soltanto attraverso queste turbine. Quindi rispetto a questa fotografia potete vedere che questa centrale idroelettrica ha al fianco anche una parte tutta legata, come dire, alla trasformazione dell'energia elettrica estratta e poi anche al trasporto. Per vostra curiosità, questo qui è l'accordo e questo, se non sbaglio, è l'uscita, non mi ricordo qual è, comunque se venendo dall'Aquila dovete andare verso nord e ve la trovate poco dopo. Questa strada poi è quella che va allo stadio, quindi parliamo di Roma Nord. Quindi se vi capita di passare sull'accordo avete la possibilità di vedere questa centrale idroelettrica completa anche dello Speedway. Now, this is another example. Indeed, here you can see a large river. Actually, okay, this is the large river and this is the Danube River. Here we have the spillway, and here you can see two power plants, one on the right bank of the river and one on the left bank of the river. So this one and this one are power plants. Now, the problem when a large river is used to extract energy by deploying, in this case, two power plants or in general a power plant, the problem is related to the navigational issues of the river. Indeed, usually, and in this case this is true, the river is used by boats in order to transport goods and so on. So, actually, when you deploy a speedway aimed at the service of these power plants, Actually, you need to foresee something that allow the boats to continue to navigate. Then, in this case, we have a kind of harbor. This is actually an harbor. And in this harbor, the boats wait until this part that are called navigation basins are free to be used. So actually the boat comes here, enter into this channel, and then can continue to navigate. It's their navigation. Now, which is the problem? That here we have an upstream water depth. Here we have a downstream water depth. Then here we need to face the jump of water depth. So the water depth here is lower than in this part. So we need to manage the difference of water depth, and we need to think something to allow the boats to navigate. So we need, this is a kind of lift, if you think. Indeed, if we make a picture from upstream, again, here this is a picture taken from upstream, we can see the power plants, that are these two power plants. Here something we have the navigation basins, and you can see the spillway here, and the water depth is different from the upstream if compared to the downstream part, and here you can see the navigation basin. Navigation basins. So this is a real problem when we deploy a kind of spillway aimed to extract energy, because in this case we need to have a difference of water depth, and then the navigation is interrupted. In order to make possible the navigation, we need to deploy also the navigation basins. So if we come here you have this part that is this part. So on the other side we have the river, and this is the navigation basins. This one is more from a qualitative point of view, this part. So the boats enter, but if we make a kind of section here, we can make it here. If we make a section here, you should see the upstream is on the left, and the downstream is on the right, downstream. Actually, we have a high water depth here and a lower depth here. So this is the water depth in the downstream part, and this is the water depth in the upstream part. So it seems at least impossible to allow the navigation from the upstream to the downstream, and from the downstream to the upstream to large boat. But actually we can deploy a kind of door here and a kind of door here. So the boat enter here, and the water are allowed to flow in the downstream part, then the water depth decrease up to this one, then we can open this door, and the boat can continue its navigation. On the other side, we can use, in this case, two doors. Here we have a high water level. Here we have a low water level. Here we have, so in this case, the boat is traveling from the upstream to the downstream. In this case, when we travel from downstream to the upstream part, we open this door, the boat enters here. This door is closed. The water is allowed to flow here. The water depth increases up to this level, then the boat is here. We open this door and the boat can continue its travel. So this is the main functioning principle of navigation basin. And then just I switch to Italian. Queste si chiamano in italiano conche di navigazione e spesso sono necessarie quando in un fiume che è navigabile, che quindi è navigato da navi o da barche in generale, è necessario ideare, pensare, quindi anche realizzare un qualche dispositivo che permetta di continuare a navigare su questo fiume anche in presenza di questi di queste opere che nella sostanza interrompono la continuità idraulica di un fiume. Quindi se io realizzo uno sfilatore per creare un dislivello che poi io posso utilizzare per estrarre energia idroelettrica, capite che la navigazione è impossibile. E quindi se il caso lo richiede, e questo è il caso del Danubio, che è un fiume notoriamente navigabile, è possibile prevedere le conche di navigazione, che sono nella sostanza una sorta di montacariche, una sorta di ascensore, lift vuol dire ascensore. Quindi quando andiamo da monte a valle, voi capite che a monte il livello è più alto che a valle, e quindi si realizza una coppia di porte, poi tra un po' vedremo che si chiamano proprio porte, sono state tra l'altro inventate da Leonardo da Vinci, infatti si chiamano porte vinciane. Quindi nella sostanza noi apriamo questa porta, facciamo entrare il galleggiante, in questo caso la nave o come volete, chiudiamo questa porta, mettiamo in comunicazione idraulica questa conca con la parte di valle e il livello scende. Nel momento in cui il livello scende, apriamo questa porta e la nave può continuare a viaggiare. Al contrario, non è molto complicato, perché nella stessa maniera la nave arriva da valle, si apre questa porta, la nave entra, si chiude questa porta, si mette in comunicazione idraulica la parte di monte con la parte di valle, il livello cresce, quindi il livello nella conca e a monte rimane lo stesso, si apre questa porta e la nave può cominciare a partire. E capite che le navi devono fare una sorta di fila e quindi è necessario realizzare questo che viene chiamato porto rifugio. Immaginatevi un evento di piena in presenza di navi, allora le navi possono essere ormeggiate in questa maniera e vedete questa, una sorta di opera foranea come si chiama, accompagna il deflusso delle acque, quindi anche la forma in questo caso è pensata a livello progettuale durante la fase di progetto di questa configurazione. Then here we can see the technical detail of this configuration. So here we have the spillway, here we have the two power plants, so this is the power plants, here we have the two navigation basins, here you can see one door downstream and more or less they are here, the two doors upstream. Then one of these navigation channel is related to the navigation from downstream to upstream and the other one from upstream to downstream in order to increase the number of boats that can use the navigation basins. And here we have the refuge harbor. This is the harbor. So this is just a kind of technical detail of the configuration we are seeing. And this is also another similar situation. Again, we have the spillway here. Here we have two power plants. This one. And you can see also this yellow line. This is actually a country board. So I mean the left bank of the river is of a country and the right one is of another country. So we need of two navigation basins. So you can see here a navigation basin here and a navigation basin here. Of course, in this case, these navigation basins are aimed to allow the navigation in the two directions. So here you can enter here. This is the harbor. So the harbor is deployed at the entrance of the navigation basin, and here you have again the power plants. Quindi vedete qui addirittura avete un grande fiume che addirittura è il confine tra due stati diversi. Quindi come vedete da una parte e dall'altra per ovvi motivi adesso le conche di navigazione sono doppie, una in riva in sponda destra e una in sponda sinistra. Quindi questa è la sponda destra e questa è la sponda sinistra, però il concetto è sempre lo stesso, avete uno sfioratore, uno spillway, avete in questo caso due centrali idroelettriche e avete le conche di navigazione, in questo caso a destra e a sinistra. Ovviamente poi c'è la parte elettrica che potete vedere qui, che è a servizio di questo, qui la vedo, probabilmente sta da queste parti, eccola qua, sta da queste parti. Quindi come vedete il concetto è più o meno sempre lo stesso. But now we can take a look to a video on YouTube. We can try. And I want to show you one of the most famous navigation basin, that is the Panama Strait. Non so se tutti lo sapete, però nella sostanza lo stretto di Panama è una conca di navigazione. It is a navigation basin, a very large, scusate, it is a very large navigation basin, but in few words, if we write here, we have the Panama, this is a kind of profile, that is some kilometers. So the spatial scale is very large in this case, not some meters, but some kilometers. And here we have a higher free surface elevation. Actually, we can say the elevation as zeta w. So we have a zeta 1 on the right, a zeta 2 on the left, that is more or less equal. But the water depth at the central part of the Panama Strait is higher than the two water level. So the boats are needed to pass. So here we have a navigation basin here and a navigation basin here, a kind of lift for very large boat. Actually, this one again are more or less two channel, and this channel is has a given width that is something like a little bit more than 100 meters. In this case, not all the ships can use the Panama Strait. Indeed, there is a kind of ship that are called Panamax. The Panamax are the ships that can use the navigation basins of the Panama Straits. So se avete sicuramente sentito parlare delle Panamax, uno pensa che le Panamax sono delle navi grandissime, in realtà sono delle navi abbastanza strette per passare nelle conche di navigazione dello Stretto di Panama. Quindi che cosa fanno queste navi? Arrivano su queste conche di navigazione, scontano la differenza di quota, passano su tutto lo stretto e poi riescono a passare dall'altra parte, in questo caso. If you want, I can show you before to see Google Earth Pro, I can show you the location of the Panama Strait, just to see, close, Panama. Of course, you can realize that Panama Strait is used by the ship in order to pass the America continent to avoid the navigation around to the south of the South America. So here, this is Panama City, and this is the Panama Strait. So as you can realize, I can try to do this. Okay, this is just for example a Panamax. This is a ship. So the ship travel here and use the navigation basin. As you can realize, here we have the two ships. Here we have the doors. One, we have one here. Now here in this picture, these doors are open, this is closed, this is another ship, another couple of doors again, and then the ships can solve the problem of having a different water depth. Indeed, you can see here that the water depth in this part is different from the water depth in this part. I can realize that here the water depth is lower if compared to this one. Then the ship can travel in this large basin, as you can realize. You can see how large is the number of the ships that use the Panama Strait, just for example to transport goods, as you can see here, and we can also measure, this is 35 meter, but as you can see the ships have a relative narrow width. Actually, the Panama Straits recently underwent maintenance work, and now the navigation basins allow also to have a wider ship. As you can see here, this is the travel, and here we have another navigation basin, as you can realize here, this one in this part, but we have also another one here. As you can realize, we have one, two, and three here, and then we are on the other side. So this is the travel of the ship. And in this video we can see more or less the travel of one of that ship. So we are going to the first navigation channel. So this is relative large ship. It is very interesting to see this ship here. Now, over there, we can see the navigation basin. So as you can realize, this is the navigation basin. This is the first one, and this is the second one. We can go over there. We can go a little bit. Okay. So we have one ship, and our ship. I don't know if you... The water depth here is higher than this one. Look at that, at those ship has increased its elevation. This is the door are open. Then the ship. This is a man, just to understand the size of the... Then we need to wait the water enter to this part. As you can realize, the water elevation is increasing. Then this door will open. We enter in this second basin. The water depth increases again. The water depth increases again right now. Okay. Then these doors are open. Okay. Now the door are open and we can continue our travel in the main water body of the Panama Strait. If we come here, we have the second. So just to realize, as you can realize, the two navigation basins are rather close to each other. Then we are navigating from this part. So this is, we used these two, and then the video is here, is here. So here is the right one, here we have the left one, the right one, and the left one. So now we are entering here. So we enter, the doors are open. You can realize, just a little bit, the water that is flowing from this basin to the downstream part. So you can see on the left the water that is released from this part to this part. As the water leave this navigation, this basin, the water depth decreases. So we need to manage the outlet of this water discharge. So we enter. I don't know if you can see this one and this one that are used to put the ship into the channel. Just here you have this one. That are used to pull the ship. And now the water depth increases, and the doors are opened, and we can continue our travel to the other side. Indeed, here we have this bridge, as you can realize, that is this bridge, this one. Then the travel continue up to the other side. So as you can see here, this large water body that is more or less, we can see this one. So now we are here. Indeed, we should turn to the left. Indeed, we have to go over there. So now we are almost here, then we need to turn to the right and we should reach this part. So we are crossing the Panama Strait. And over there we can see the navigation basins again. So just to let you understand the functioning of navigation basins. This is our friend, the other ship. We use in this case the left one, so we are here more or less. We are using this one, the left one. This we are now here. So we need to wait. You can see, look at the right ship. Now the door is closed. You should see that the door are closed here. And look at the variation of the water depth. This is a lift, basically. Now the door in the here will be opened. As you can see here, these are used to. Now the navigation basins are used by more than one ship. As you can realize, these are very small if compared to the water depth decreases, but also on the Princess Cruises. And you can see also the water depth over there, how low is if compared to the water depth in this part. Look at the very high difference of water depth, and you can look also at this ship, and also we are going down. The doors are opened again, and eventually we have finished our travel, so the water depth decreases. And we can continue to navigate to the other side, and that's all. So actually, we can reach the open sea, that is this one, the open sea in the other side. So we have reached this part, we navigated here, and this is the open sea. Non so, ragazzi, se avete capito il funzionamento delle conche di navigazione. Comunque, di fatto, sono una sorta di ascensore per le navi o comunque in generale per i natanti. So we have more or less understood that usually we need to also to design a series of hydraulic structures that is not needed directly to reach the aim of the project. In this case, the project is related to extract energy. So we deploy a spillway, and a power plant. And that's all. But in this case, if the river is used also to be navigated by the ships, then we need to design also the navigation basin. In this case, navigation basins, because we have one on one side and one on the other side. So we need to know what are the main problems related to the deployment of the hydraulic structure that we are designing. But when we look at a spillway, as in this case, you can realize that this one is our standard shape, standard configuration of a spillway. I can sketch it on the upper right part of this slide. But also here we can see something strange. Indeed, here we have this strange thing that is a gate that is used to control the flood, to control the functioning of this spillway. And also we need to deploy these concrete structure that are the piles. Piles. Actually, this is a pile, but we can have a lot of piles. Did you can see here we have another spillway, 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 spillway. Here we have another one, here we have another one. So we have a lot of piles that are used to manage the using of gates. Indeed, when we have a spillway, in this case we can see that this is a Shimemi profile. Shimemi profile. Indeed, as you can realize, this is the basin profile. In this case, we have, of course, the water depth upstream, or if you want, the hydraulic head. If the velocity in the upstream part, this is also the effective, the actual hydraulic head in the upstream. This is the transitional part of the profile that is used to connect to the horizontal part located downstream. So up to now we have talked about the shape of the profile. Then this profile should be connected to the horizontal part downstream. Now, from a practical point of view, it is really true that it is simple to understand that in the upstream part we have a slow motion, that here we have a Froude number lower than one, to a fast flow in which the Froude number is higher than one. But again, downstream we have a Froude number lower than one. Then, of course, an hydraulic jump occurs here. Hydraulic jump occurs here. Now, related to the hydraulic jump, we can relate to the hydraulic jump a kind of energy dissipation. Then, if you realize, we are using the hydraulic jump to dissipate energy. So when we realize that when we deploy a spillway, the true problem is to dissipate energy. Then we use a natural phenomenon that is the hydraulic jump, hydraulic jump, that from a physical point of view dissipates energy. Now the problem is that we want that the hydraulic jump occurs as close as possible to the spillway. Indeed, the dissipation can move the sediments, can modify the section in the downstream part of the river. So we need to design not only this part, but also the part placed downstream the spillway in which the hydraulic jump must occur. So we need to design also the so-called stilling basin. So the stilling basin is a portion of the river placed downstream the spillway in which the main dissipation must occur. So the dissipation must occur within the stilling basin. So we have two problems. We need to understand where the hydraulic jump occurs, but this does not suffice to us. We want that hydraulic jump occurs where we want, not where he wants. So we need to modify the configuration of the downstream part of a spillway in order to force the hydraulic jump to occur just close to the spillway. So, from a practical point of view, we need to observe that from this section up to this section, actually the dissipation are very low. Indeed, as you can realize, we are using this equation. So, if the hydraulic head does not change with space, I mean its derivative is equal to zero, I'm saying that the hydraulic head is conserved. I mean the dissipations are very low, are negligible. So we can use remember that H, the hydraulic head, is equal to the elevation of the bed plus the water depth plus Q squared over 2G omega squared. So this is the kinetic head, and here we have the elevation of the bed and the water depth. Actually, here we are saying that if this is the section 1 and here we have the section 2, this relationship can be written as H1 is equal H2. Now we need a kind of datum, a reference level in which we can write the elevation of the bed. So if this is zeta equal to 0, we have zeta b here is equal to 0. Y is equal to this parameter that is the height of the spillway plus this one, H0. Indeed, we wrote A plus H0. In the downstream part, we have the elevation of the bottom that is again 0, the water depth that we call H1, and the velocity. Of course, Q squared over 2g omega squared is equal to V squared over 2g. Now, you can realize that here we don't use the kinetic head. Actually, in the upstream part, the velocity is so low that we can assume that is very low if compared to the summation of A and H0. So here we are writing V0 over 2G squared plus this is negligible. From here, actually, we can obtain the value of H1. Indeed, the velocity is equal to Q squared over the wetted area in section 1, that is a function of H1. So actually the unknowns are only one. We don't know only H1 as Q is a known parameter. Just for example, in this case, this is 80 cubic meter per second. And here we can use H1, and we can compute H1 equal to about 90 centimeter. Now, the hydraulic jump occurs here only if H2 is the conjugate water depth to H1. I don't know if you remember, we talked about the hydrodynamic load. We call it the specific force. You remember when we talked about the hydraulic jump, we used if this is y, this is s, the specific force. We have this one, this is the critical water depth. If we have H1 here, for which we have a specific force equal to S1, hydraulic jump occurs in this location only if in the downstream part the water depth is equal to H2 for which S1 is equal to S2. Okay? Then from a practical point of view, we can also compute the water depth that must occur downstream if the hydraulic jump is here. Now the problem is related to the fact that this is H1, the water depth just downstream the speedway. Then we have the water depth that must occur downstream if the hydraulic jump occurs here. Now, this water depth is only fictitious, is not real. Indeed, if this is a subcritical flow, in the downstream part, the normal flow water depth occurs. So we can hear YU. So in the downstream part, the real water depth is 2.60 meter. I mean, in the downstream part, we have not this water depth, but a lower one. We have this one, HN. We can call this HN, the water depth in normal condition. So we can see that in the downstream part, the specific force SN is lower than the upstream part. I mean, here we have a specific force equal to S1. Here we have a specific force equal to Sn, and Sn is lower than S1. Then the hydraulic jump tends to travel downstream, and we don't want that this happen. I switch just a little bit to Italian. So se avete capito, allora adesso noi stiamo parlando del fatto che noi vogliamo che il risalto idraulico stia il più vicino possibile al piede dello scivolatore. Questo è il nostro obiettivo. Ma perché vogliamo questo? Allora, innanzitutto vogliamo che ci sia un risalto idraulico. Perché vogliamo che ci sia un risalto idraulico? Perché naturalmente riusciamo a dissipare energia. E quando ci sono gli scivolatori, cosiddetti speedway, il vero problema è dissipare l'energia a valle. Perché immaginatevi, c'è quest'acqua che prima rallenta, poi deve superare questo scivolatore. Diventa ovviamente una corrente veloce e poi da qualche parte dobbiamo dissipare l'energia, perché altrimenti potremmo andare incontro ad erosione della parte di valle e una serie di problematiche. Quindi il vero problema è dissipare energia e noi possiamo dissipare energia soltanto sfruttando il fenomeno fisico della dissipazione, che vi ricordo è sempre legato all'intrappolamento di aria, è l'aria che entra nell'acqua e dissipa energia. E abbiamo visto che uno di questi fenomeni è proprio il risalto idraulico. Quindi vogliamo che ci sia risalto idraulico, però non vogliamo che se ne vada dove gli pare, perché associato alla dissipazione energetica ci possono essere delle problematiche. Quindi il problema, se lo vogliamo declinare in maniera precisa, è: vogliamo che ci sia un risalto idraulico al piede dello sfioratore. Quindi notate la differenza, come dire, sottile. Se noi fossimo nell'ambito di uno studio di quello che succede, andremo a ricostruire i profili come abbiamo fatto all'inizio del corso. Prendiamo lo speedway, abbiamo una condizione al contorno, ci calcoliamo la profondità al piede dello speedway, vediamo dove si verifica il risalto idraulico. In questo caso, ad esempio, come avrete intuito che la spinta idrodinamica di monte è più grande della spinta idrodinamica di valle, e come abbiamo visto l'altro giorno in laboratorio, il risalto si muove fino ad raggiungere la sezione in cui le due spinte si eguagliano. Ora qui, quello che possiamo dire è: guarda, la spinta di monte, S1, è più grande della spinta di valle, Sn. Non ci chiediamo dove si verifica il risalto, ma ci fermiamo e diciamo non ci va bene, perché noi vogliamo che il risalto stia lì, cioè dobbiamo inventarci qualcosa per tenere il risalto idraulico al piede dello sfioratore. Non vogliamo sapere dove va, vogliamo che stia dove diciamo noi. E per far questo dobbiamo modificare la geometria. So in this case, we are not satisfied about this situation. Indeed, if S1 is higher than Sn, it means that the hydraulic jump does not occur here, but it will occur somewhere downstream. But we don't like that the hydraulic jump occurs in a section located too far from the spillway. We want that the hydraulic jump occurs at the spillway in order to make a kind of stealing basin. I mean, we can use concrete, we can protect the river, but we want to protect only for a limited area and close to the spillway. So in this case, we have understood that the hydraulic jump does not occur here. So we need to change something. And what we can do? We can decrease the elevation of the bottom. So if this is the natural elevation of the river, we want to decrease the elevation of the bottom in a limited area downstream the speedway in order to write again this equation. I mean H1 equal to H2. I mean, if this is the section 1 and if this one is the section 2, now this is the datum, the reference level. Then here you can realize that this one, if we call this dimension A, we have another parameter here. How we can define the value of A? I mean the value of the decrease of the elevation of the steading basin in the downstream part. We can use a very empirical formulation where H2 is this value, H2, and H, oh sorry, and this is Hn. So from a really empirical by means of a really empirical relationship, we can select a value of the parameter A. Remember, A is this one. So the decrease of the elevation of the bottom of the stilling basin. So we repeat the computation. So we have a different value of H1, but this H1 has two main differences with the previous cases. The first one is the value. Before we had 0.90, here we have 0.80. So I mean the water depth has decreased of about 10 centimeters. But we have also another difference. Indeed, this 0.76 is measured from this elevation, not from this one. So, of course, this point is lower than the first one. So, this point, if we call this one H1 star, with respect to this one, we are here, H1 star. So it is really lower than the first one. Then, as before, we update also the value of H2, that now is equal to 3.80 centimeter, but again, It is related to the bottom of the distilling basin. So here we can see that the normal water depth in the downstream part is higher than this one. Then I mean the specific force coming from downstream is higher than this one. Then the hydraulic jump is kept to the downstream, is kept very close to the spillway. And then we add a last information that we need, that is the length of the steaming basin. The length of the steaming basin that is more or less equal to the length of the hydraulic jump. So we have the spillway that we are able to design. By means of this method, we know that we need to decrease the elevation of the steaming basin, and we know also the length of the steaming basin. This is a really simple example of the design of a steaming basin to be deployed just downstream a spillway. The steaming basin to be deployed just downstream a spillway. And let's try to see again a video on YouTube. And you can see this one. This is a really very big, very large spillway. So what we can see? The shape of the spillway. Here we have a very slow flow, of course. The Froude number here is lower than one. Actually, here we have almost still water, so the Froude number is close to zero. Then here the overflow occurs, and here, as you can realize, the water is white because air is entrained into the water and then dissipation is occurring. In this case, the dissipation is occurring not thanks to an hydraulic jump, at least not here, but by deviating the flow to greater elevation in order to allow the air to be entrained into the water. So here we are using the air to dissipate energy. Of course, downstream this water will experience also an hydraulic jump in which the last part of energy will be dissipated. Quindi, come vedete, questo è proprio un esempio molto simile a quello che abbiamo visto fino ad adesso. A monte abbiamo un deflusso lento, ovviamente, addirittura qui l'acqua è ferma. Qui, come vedete, l'acqua è bianca, che vuol dire che c'è intrappolamento di aria e quindi si sta dissipando energia. Ma come vedete, qui la dissipazione non è fatta con un risalto idraulico, ma deviando il deflusso verso l'alto, in maniera tale da favorire l'intrappolamento di aria. Ovviamente così non si dissipa tutta l'energia, ma l'acqua poi andrà a finire in una vasca di dissipazione in cui si verificherà un risalto idraulico molto probabilmente, in cui grazie al quale la dissipazione dell'energia che rimane sostanzialmente. If we continue to see this video, we can see in the downstream part, here you can see how the air enters into the water, and here we have the steaming basin that must be of course protected by means of concrete and so on. So one of the problems in designing this kind of structure is the protection of the steaming basin. So you can realize as the jet increases its width due to the entrainment of the air entrainment. Just to be complete, this kind of speedway is called ski jump as the sport of the winter sport, because this is more like as a ski jump as the sport. Questo, per capirci, è chiamato sfioratore a salto di sci, perché questa forma è molto simile al trampolino che si fa per lo sport invernale, non so se l'avete mai visto. Per cui quest'acqua viene deviata verso l'alto, si favorisce la dissipazione, e qui vedete quanta aria viene intrappolata in questo deflusso, lo vedete anche da quanto è largo il getto, poi l'energia che rimane si dissipa nella vasca di dissipazione. Quindi una delle problematiche più importanti quando si progetta una cosa del genere è la protezione del fondo della vasca di dissipazione. Indeed, the protection of the stilling basin bottom is very, very, very important. Indeed, just to, let's try to, here we have this one. Here we have the ski jump. This is something like that. So the water here is more or less still. We have this one, and here we have the jet with a lot of air. Actually, the air is in this jet. Of course, this jet, here you can realize that here we have a water depth, and here the water continue to flow in the downstream part. Here we have something like that. Water. Here we have dissipation, and here we have the water that go downstream. Now the problem is this one, that the velocity can reach the bottom of the stilling basin. And if the protection of the bottom, just for example by means of concrete, but not always, we can have a scour here. And this scour can evolve depending on the value of the water discharge, because the jet can fall here, but also here. So we can have a kind of scour that can treat the stability of the dam, of the spillway itself. Indeed, if we are not able to protect the stilling basin, we can have a hole just downstream the spillway, and the spillway can collapse. So the design of the stilling basin is very, very important. Cioè, il dimensionamento della vasca di dissipazione forse è la cosa più importante, è ancora più importante di come si progetta lo sfioratore vero e proprio. Perché se non riusciamo a proteggere adeguatamente la vasca di dissipazione, si potrebbe creare, in linea di principio, uno scavo che potrebbe raggiungere il limite di valle dello sfioratore. Voi immaginate un'opera di calcestruzzo e qui sotto uno scavo che di fatto destabilizza dal punto di vista strutturale geotecnico l'opera. Quindi l'opera cade. Questo è il concetto. L'opera cade. Ma giusto per darvi un'idea, c'è una diga in Africa che fu costruita negli anni 70 più o meno, anni 80 forse, con uno sfilatore di questo tipo. Se io vi chiedessi, ma secondo voi un getto di questo tipo, con una vasca di dissipazione progettata, quindi non improvvisata, quanto può scavare come ordine di grandezza? Io penso che voi poteste dire qualcosa del tipo 5 metri, 6 metri. Qualcuno di voi volesse esagerare e mi direbbe 10 metri. In realtà, questo scavo, in quel caso specifico, arrivato a 70 metri, che vuol dire che voi non potete usare più questo sfioratore. Quindi la stima, che è molto complicata, dello scavo nella vasca di dissipazione è un aspetto particolarmente delicato. Questo soltanto per farvi capire che spesso, quando si realizzano queste opere, questo tipo di problema può essere risolto, siccome è molto complicato, o con modellazioni molto molto spinte, quindi anche molto costose se volete, o con esperimenti, o sulla base di esperienze passate. Ma questo soltanto per dirvi che questo aspetto è un aspetto cruciale nel dimensionamento di uno sfioratore. Di uno sfioratore. E guardando questo video potreste anche immaginare che so just before as you can see here, the water depth in the downstream part, and here you can see the downstream part of the. We can enjoy this video just for. I want to show you the downstream part, okay? And here you can see here, it is not very interesting that part. Okay, so here you have a fast flow air entrainment through number higher than one. Just a little bit here. And in the downstream part, you have a subcritical flow. The flow number here is lower than one. So this is more or less the steeping basin. And here somewhere an hydraulic jump is occurring. You can see also. So this is a large structure. As you can see, if you visit YouTube, you will find a lot of videos about a lot of videos about hydraulic structure in general. One, this is a kind of suggestion of YouTube, and again you have the dam, the overflow, the spillway. This is a ski jump. Just an example, this is the electrical devices. So usually that large dam are deployed in order to extract energy. So this is the power plant, the electrical components of the power plant. And you can realize this is water. This is the spray of the water. And also here we have a ski jump when only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5 gates are used instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this is not. This is the same dam that we have seen before, but with a lower number of gates open. This is the green part of the. Okay. So this is the usual configuration of this large hydraulic structure. Okay? Can continue to see something. Indeed, this one is the stilling basin. Stilling basin. This is a picture that I taken some time ago, and you can see that we have another approach to the definition of the configuration of the distilling basin. Just to understand, if this is the spillway, here we have something like that. So we can use also, so in this case, the hydraulic jump will be forced to occur into the steeling basin thanks to this downstream portion of the steeling basin, that is this one. So we can have a different kind of configuration in order to force the hydraulic jump to occur into the steeling basin. In this case, we don't have a decrease of the elevation of the steeling basin bottom, just for example, because here the excavation is too difficult to deploy, to make during the works. So we can select other configurations as in this case. So you can see here this wall that is used to force the rolling jump into the steeling basin. And also you can see how the steeling basin is protected by means of this concrete sheet. Actually, these are a kind of cube of concrete in order to protect the bottom of the steeling basin. But also we can see here, this is the outlet of a diversion work, but this is not so important. But here we have a kind of series of macro roughness. So a series of large elements that are able to dissipate energy and then to force the hydraulic jump to be within the steeling basin. Also, you can see here that we have the wall at the downstream part, exactly as this one, but also you can see that the water are allowed to flow in the lower part of this wall. So when the water discharge is very large, the water level is this one, and the flow can occur also here, but an increased water depth occurs in the steeling basin, and then the dissipation of the energy is more effective. Now, from a practical point of view, as we have seen, the spillway, that is this one, can be also deployed by using gates. The gates are this movable part of the structure, in order to manage the overflow of the spillway. So just for example, here we can see this gate that at its rest position is part of the spillway. So just for example, if this is the shape of a spillway, we have here a gate that when closed is part of the spillway configuration. When raised, as in this case, can be used to manage the overflow. So we can move this gate in order to allow an higher elevation of the water of the free surface in the upper part. Here you can see the pile, this one, the pile. Also in this case we have the same configuration, and here you can see a picture related to the to this kind of gate. So we use a kind of hydraulic device in order to move this gate. And you can understand that the load due to the water, I mean the hydraulic load due to the water, are transferred to the foundation directly on the pile, on the spillway. So here I have kind of load due to the presence of water, and this load is transferred to the spillway foundation here. So in this case we have the gate that can be lowered, and the load is transferred to the foundation of the spillway itself. And we can have different kind of these type of gates. This is another kind with two gates that when lowered are more or less as this one, or as in this case, more or less the principle is the same. Here we have the pile, here we have the loads that is transferred to the foundation of the spillway, and when the gate are lowered, they are part of the spillway itself. So in this case you can see here the spillway, you can see here the spillway. As you can understand, in this part a part of the spillway is missing. As you can realize, this is an edge of the spillway, but here we have the gate that when lowered in this part make possible to have this profile. So these gates, actually these two, are lowered, and as you can realize, the load is transferred directly on the spillway foundation. But also we can have some different deployment of this kind of gate. As you can realize, this is the gate, this is the pile, and this is the sketch. So instead of transfer the load, this load, instead of transfer the load on the foundation of the spillway, in this case the load are transferred on the piles here. So here we have a kind of device that is used to raise or to lower. This is the lowered location, this one. In this case, this device is in this configuration. When the gate is raised, the configuration is this one. And this is used, this is a kind of weight that is used to get low the action needed to move the gate. So here you can see this is a portion of the pile, this is the pile, the action, the hydraulic load acting on the gate here are transferred here by means of this device, and here we have the weight that are used to move the gate by means of a typical configuration of the device. So you can see here a sensor, here we can see the center of the movement of the displacement device that is allowed to have a kind of automatic behavior. And this is the same picture taken from downstream. So this is the gate, can guess that this is a metal component. And here we have this one that is inged to the gate itself, and this is the weight. But we can have also different kind of gates. This is just, for example, vertical gates. And in this case, as you can realize, they are a kind of wall that can be moved along the vertical direction. So here we can have a kind of electric motor that can be used to raise the vertical gates, just for example in this case. And the gates, of course, need of this particular configuration of the piles that are called logs, or in Italian gargami, come gargami. So in Italian is gargami. And of course, the hydraulic load are transferred to the pile. So when you cooperate with the structural engineer, he or she needs to know the hydraulic load for which the piles should be designed. So here we act as hydraulic engineer. Here we act as structural engineer, in general civil engineer. And here you can have a kind of wheels that allow to move the vertical gate. As you can realize, this is the gate. This is the chain. This is the motor. And this is the log where the gate can travel. The log here, the log here. Il gargame. But also, you can see here the log. This is the gate. This is the pile. And of course, the hydraulic load here, as in this case, the hydraulic load here is transferred to the pile, as in this case. In this case, the difference with the previous picture is that the movement, the displacement of the gate, is not obtained by using an electric motor, but by using a mechanical device. So something must take this gate and install into the log, as we can see here. So this is a picture taken from downstream. So here you have a kind of road in which a mechanical device can be used to take this gate, or this one, and to move here and to install the gate. But also we can have, so you realize that in this case the action of the water are transferred to the pile, but we can have also different shape of the gate. In this case we have a kind of circular gate that is inged into the pile. This is the pile. Lì qua avete una cerniera. The gate can be raised or lowered by rotating along this ing, and this is the ing, just to understand. And the water load is transferred by means of this ing to the pile. So this is the pile. This is the gate that is metal. We have a kind of metallic frame. And the load are transferred here. So when they are lowered and the water is here, we have that the load is transferred to the pile. But also you can see here that we could have the needings of maintain this one, this gate. So usually we have also a couple of locks into the pile in order to put a vertical gate, at least a modular gate, for which here we can dry this area and make some maintenance work here. Quindi, come vedete, in questo caso questa è una paratoia circolare che ruota attorno a questo fulcro e praticamente nella sostanza i carichi sono trasferiti direttamente sulle pile. Ora, nel caso in cui volessimo mantenere la paratoia, qui comunque ci sono dei gargami in cui si mette una paratoia verticale, anche se diciamo provvisoria, che permette di far passare, di tenere all'asciutto questa zona e quindi di fare manutenzione alla paratoia. E queste tipicamente non sono delle vere e proprie paratoie verticali, ma sono, questi qua sono chiamati in italiano panconi di tura, panconi di tura. Cioè praticamente immaginate che questo qua è un pancone di tura che viene calato dall'alto, vengono calati uno sopra l'altro, c'è un dispositivo di tenuta tra l'uno e l'altro che per peso proprio non permette la tenuta idraulica, per cui qui potete stare all'asciutto e al sicuro e quindi queste paratoie possono essere soggette a manutenzione così come di solito deve essere previsto. So, bye! Coming back to our spillway, here we have a gate that can be lowered here. Here we have a circular gate that transfer the load to the pile. So here we have one kind of gate in these two spillway, but also another part here and here. And we can see another kind of circular gate. This is the pile, this is the ing. This is the bridge used to maintain this gate. Here we can see a beam used to move the gate and also this structure in which the electric motor is used to rotate this beam and then to raise this gate. And this is more or less how this one is seen from upstream. Here you can see the beam. Here we have the motors. And this beam rotate. This is a chain that is hinged here. Then when this rotate, this one is raised, as you can, oh, sorry, as you can realize. Now, why, as we said in the last lecture, we need to deploy and then to design a series of hydraulic structures in order, just for example, to convey the water discharge in a different flume, in a different channel. And then we can make the example of the so-called flood retention basins. Actually, we have already described this structure, this configuration, but we can recall it. So you have a a river in which a water discharge flows, and actually this is related to a Latin period, we can have somewhere here a urban area. So this is an urban area. For which this water discharge is not compatible with the section of the channel crossing this urban area. So I mean, we can increase the size of the channel within the urban area, or we can decrease the value of the water discharge that is incoming. One of the solution, the possible solution, is to deploy a kind of spillway here in order to fill a water volume here, and then to decrease the incoming water discharge. This is Q dot, the incoming hydrograph, and downstream, we can write this one downstream, the water discharge is something like that, just for example. But another situation can be, another possible solution is something like that. So here we have again our urban area. Here we have the Q dot that is incoming. Instead of using a water pond, a flood retention basin located along the river, we can use a lateral spillway that allow the flooding of a retention basin located on one side of the river, and then we can allow the water to come back to the river after the end of the flood. So in this case, as we have already seen, we can have, this is time, this is the hydrograph, this is the incoming water discharge, this is the downstream water discharge, and we can, if you remember, we have a kind of this water discharge, and after some times we need to empty the retention basins, the retention basin. So actually, in some cases, we can deploy a series of hydraulic structure in order to decrease the water discharge, or by means of a retention basin deployed directly along the river, or on one side of the river. So in this presentation, we can see this structure. This is the main river. This is the water discharge Q dot. This is the downstream water discharge, and this is the water volume that allow to decrease the maximum value of the water discharge. But in another configuration, we have the same river, just for example this one, a small structure here, even if smaller than this one, and a lateral spillway for which the water does not fill this area, but an area located on one side of the river. And here we have another structure that allows to convey the water discharge at the end of the event, allow to convey the water discharge back to the river. So, in one case, we have a kind of tools able to estimate the needed volume. So, this is the difference of the incoming water discharge and the downstream water discharge. Of course, if we make the integral of the difference up to this time, we have the water of volume that is maintained into this water body. In the other side, we have the incoming, where we are, the incoming water discharge, the downstream water discharge, that is this one, and of course, this is the water volume that is conveyed into the water body located in one side of the river. So we can compute this one. Indeed, in order to solve this problem, we have this equation: inlet minus downstream. And we have already faced this problem. This is the problem of reservoir flooding, or reservoir routing, if you remember. In this case, at least from a qualitative point of view, we are able also to build a model able to compute the downstream water discharge. We can compute the incoming water discharge by means of statistical analysis tools, and then we can know which is the volume needed to decrease the water discharge from this value down to this value. So as you can understand, then from a practical point of view, we can have a different configuration of the flood retention basins. Just for example, in this case, we have the river here. This is incoming. Here we have a kind of structures able to increase the water depth here. Then the water can fill this first part of the retention basin. When this first part is filled with water, the water can flood also this one, and then also this one, and then also this one, and then also the last one. So we can have different configuration of retention basins, but the main idea remains the same. So just for example, we had exactly the same. So the river comes in this direction. So we have this one. Here we have a structure aimed to increase the water depth here. Here we have a lateral spillway, that is this one, that fills first this one. Then here we have a kind of spillway directly embedded into the retention basin. Then this one is filled, then this one is filled, then this one is filled, and then we have the outlet works. So if here we have a kind of urban area, the water the water discharge flowing downstream is low if compared to this one by using this retention basin. But again, this is an example of a structure here that allow to flood this one, this area. In this case, the retention basin is not deployed in one side of the river, but directly along the river. You can realize that in this case, in this case, we need the outlet works. In this case, this structure is the structure, the hydraulic structure that allow to fill this water, this area, and when the water discharge, the event is finished, this is also the outlet works. Indeed, the water can continue to flow downstream this structure. In a few slides, we will see how the structure is how this structure is made. Indeed, we can take a look to a real structure. So what we have here? We have a kind of spillway, so we can make a kind of spillway, but as you can realize here, the water is allowed to flow in this part. So when the water discharge is low, the water depth here upstream and the water depth here downstream is almost the same because the water are allowed to flow under, beneath the spillway. And here we can see this strange man-made object that are macro roughness. Indeed, as you can realize, the water, when the water discharge increases, the water depth increases, and of course, the flow occurs only here. And here, the velocity could be very high. So we use this kind of devices, of structure, in order to increase the energy dissipations. When the water discharge increases again, we have the flow occurring both on top of the spillway and under the spillway. So in this case, we can have in general a kind of water flow occurring here when the water discharge is not so high as a free flow, so with the free surface located here. When the water discharge increases, the flow occurs again here, but without free surface. When the water discharge increases again, the water flow occurs both in the lower part of the spillway and on the higher part of the spillway. So we have in general three different hydraulic behavior. When the water flows under the spillway, under this part, when the flow occurs in this way, or when the flow occurs both in this part and in this part. So just to have another example again, we can have this case. Here we have the spillway. Here we have, I don't know if you can realize that here we have the holes that allow the water flow to occur here. And then we have these macro roughness elements in one, two, three, four rows, and here we have the river. So we can see the spillway, the holes in the downstream part, the macro roughness that allows the dissipation of the energy of the flow occurring here, or here, and here. So this is another kind of another view. And here we can see the rotation basin. So somewhere here we have a lateral spillway, perhaps here, that can fill this water. Indeed, here we have the structure. Here we have the lateral spillway. Here we have the retention basin. And here we have the outlet works. So when a flood occurs, usually when the water discharge is low enough, the lateral spillway does not work and the water is allowed to continue under this structure. When the water discharge increases, the water level increases too and the lateral spillways start to overflow, and this area is flooded. Of course, the water depth here increases, and then this is efficient from an hydraulic point of view. Here the flow continues to occur, but the water discharge here is lower if compared to the upstream one. When the flood is finished, then the outlet works can be used to empty this area. And this is a close-up of the outlet work. This is the spillway that we had seen in one of the slides. But we can, as usually, see some video just to, again on YouTube, this is the upstream part. Then in this case, the water depth is the free surface elevation is lower than the crest of the spillway, but is higher than the upper edge of the holes in the lower part of the spillway. So in this case, the water flow is occurring in this part, indeed, as you can realize. As you can realize, the hydraulic jump is confined into this part of the stilling basin, just downstream the spillway. Indeed, they are almost submerged, but they increase the dissipation, as you can realize here. So here the water flow is relatively calm. As you can see here, we have these floaters that can represent a problem, but we can see also the same situation, I guess. Okay, no, keep. Where is this one? Sorry, I have to search. We are here. Can go here. We can see the situation. Okay. More or less the same. Here you can see the dissipation that is increased due to the increase of the water discharge coming from upstream. The water elevation is higher than the previous videos. You can realize that the water discharge is higher here. This is the effect of the macro roughness elements. Here we have the problem of the floaters that must be managed. And as you can realize, in the upstream part, the area is flooded, but in the downstream is not. So somebody has designed this structure in order to activate, remember, the lateral spillway that is flooding the retention basin that is located in the upstream part. But also we can see also another video. When the water discharge is again increased, you can see the dissipation. Here you can have this problem. I hope that you have realized that the air can be a problem for the hydraulic structure. Indeed, here we have the hole that make possible the flow of water, but also we have a kind of swirl of a vortex in which the air can enter into the hole and can treat the spillway stability from a structural point of view, because the air entrainment can lead to vibrations of the structure. So se avrete capito, dico in italiano, che l'aria da una parte aiuta in generale la progettazione di opere idrauliche, però noi dobbiamo tenere sempre conto. Ad esempio, vi faccio vedere qui come, qui capite che cosa sta succedendo. Il livello qui è più basso della cresta dello sfioratore, quindi il deflusso avviene soltanto in quelle aperture che ci sono nella parte bassa. Ovviamente qui c'è un deflusso piuttosto forte perché è una luce sottobattente, qui vedete le dissipazioni, ma questa luce, in particolare questa, oltre che a richiamare acqua, richiama anche aria. Qui vedete una sorta di vortice. Vi farò vedere la prossima volta in che cosa consiste questo richiamo di aria, però in realtà immaginatevi un tornado nell'acqua che fa entrare aria qui dentro e può minacciare la stabilità strutturale di questi sfioratori, perché inducono delle vibrazioni molto forti. Infatti provate a concentrarvi in quest'area, quindi provate a concentrarvi qui e guardate che cosa succede. Aspettate, mi mando un po' più indietro quando si vede. Quindi mantenete, pay attention, focus your attention here. As you can realize, air is entrained and can treat the stability of the spillway due to vibrations related to the air entrainment. This is a typical. We can also see the suggestion of YouTube. This is the general looking of retention basin. So they are basically retention basins are a kind of area that can be flooded. We need to manage the flooding of this area, more or less. So as you can realize, they can be also be very large. You can see something else. So different portion of the retention basin. Okay. Nothing interesting without water discharge, actually. Okay. We continue. And here, just to say another, to see another example. In this case, we have the water discharge flowing in this direction. As you can realize, we have not any structure along the river. we have only a lateral spillway. In this case, this lateral spillway, if I make a section here, is more or less something like that. Actually, I should make the section in this other. So here we have this one, and we have this one. So when the water depth is higher than the elevation of this part, the flow occurs, and this area that now is really empty, indeed you can see here, so the water can fill all this area with water, and here we have the outlet work. So when here we will have a kind of gate that can be managed to allow the outlet work. So when the outlet of the water discharge. So when the flood event is finished and this area is totally flooded, the outlet works can be used to convey the water discharge to the river, and this area is ready to the next event. Now, from a practical point of view, the retention basin must be designed. Indeed, what it means that a retention basin must be designed? We need to identify where the water can be filled, can be stored, first of all. And then we need to know how large should be the water, the volume of water that is needed to be stored within the retention basin. Quindi, veramente in pochissime parole e in maniera secondo me anche piuttosto semplice, cosa vuol dire dimensionare una cassa di espansione in derivazione? Uno, identificare il luogo in cui l'acqua può inondare una porzione di territorio. Quindi dovremmo espropriare, dovremmo fare una serie di operazioni, ma la prima cosa è identificare l'area. E secondo poi, sapere quanta acqua deve essere immagazzinata, tra virgolette, in queste casse di espansione. E quindi il progetto si traduce nell'identificazione dell'area, nella stima della capacità necessaria affinché la portata in ingresso sia diminuita di una quantità nota, che è quella di progetto. Quindi l'obiettivo progettuale è quello di far diminuire la portata. Per diminuire la portata abbiamo bisogno di una vasca di adeguata capacità. Questo è un po' il concetto. Then, in order to design, at least at the preliminary stage, we can write here preliminary stage of a project, we know the maximum value of the incoming water discharge. Is it true? Cioè, I mean, I can estimate the maximum value of the incoming water discharge? The answer is, of course, yes. Indeed, we need to use statistical analysis. So for a given latent period, we can estimate the maximum value of water discharge. On the other hand, we have also the maximum value of the downstream water discharge. I mean, the value of the water discharge that is compatible with the urban area, just for example. So I mean, by coming back here we have the maximum Q max I, that is this value. This value is the maximum water discharge that can be conveyed into the channel crossing the urban area, just as an example. I mean, we can define both of these values. On the other side of the equation, we have the basin, the retention basin volume, I mean its capacity, and the volume of the incoming hydrograph. Indeed, you can realize that this value does not suffice to understand which is this volume. Indeed, I can have an incoming water discharge like this, an incoming water discharge like this, and of course we can have a downstream water discharge like this, for which this is the volume that fills this area. But in the second case, by changing, we can have something like that, and then the volume is different. So you realize that the maximum value of the incoming water discharge does not suffice to understand the volume of water that need to be stored into the retention basin. So also the total volume of the hydrograph should be taken into account. Indeed, here we have the flood wave volume. So if we have QT, the design hydrograph, this is W incoming. Of course, this is a really simple and empirical relationship, but it could be very useful, at least in the preliminary stage. Indeed, we can identify an area, then we can estimate the available basin volume, then we can estimate the design hydrograph, and then we can use this one to get the decrease of the incoming water discharge if compared to the downstream one, and then to compare to the objective of the project. So actually this relationship is very simple but very useful, and of course some assumptions have been made to obtain this relationship. The first one is the overflow is not controlled by gates, no gates. And also that the incoming hydrograph has this synthetic shape in which this one can be obtained by means of statistical analysis. Of course, this relationship can be written also within the frame of rainfall runoff method. Instead of using the volume of the incoming hydrograph, we can start from the rainfall depth, from the parameters phi, from the extension of the watershed, from the maximum water depth within the retention basin, and to the area of the retention basin, the fingerprint area. So these are two empirical relationships that are saying mainly the same things, that can be used to estimate the needed volume, or for a given volume, the maximum decrease, the decrease of the maximum value of water discharge. Quindi capite che queste relazioni, seppur semplici, possono essere usate per un progetto preliminare di una vasca di espansione. Infatti, cioè, se ci pensate a un punto di vista pratico, non è che voi dite, vabbè, mi servono 100.000 metri cubi di posto dove mettere l'acqua e la vado a cercare nel territorio. No. Prima vedete dove è possibile immagazzinare quest'acqua. E quindi è il territorio, se volete, che comanda, che vi dice qual è il volume di acqua che può essere immagazzinato in vasche di espansione in derivazione, come in questo caso. Dall'altra parte, però, avete bisogno di uno strumento che vi dica con quell'area a disposizione, o meglio con quel volume a disposizione, qual è la diminuzione del valore massimo della portata in ingresso. E quindi è una relazione che da una parte è molto semplice, ma dall'altra è anche molto efficace nel predimensionamento di queste opere. So, as we have said before, W. That is the capacity, if you want, capacity of the rotation basin is related to the availability on the land of the retention basin. So we need to define the areas that can be flooded and the main components of the interventions, of course. So if we need to deploy leaves, argini, if we need to deploy the outlet works, the inlet works, I mean the lateral spillway, and so on. So, in particular, we need to estimate one of these parameters, I mean this one, these ones. Now, if we want, and usually at the next stage of a design, we need to make a detailed design of the rotation basin. But we are perfectly able to design in a detailed, with great detail, a rotation basin. Indeed, we need to use these, we need to solve this equation. Now, here, V is the volume of water into the rotation basin. This is the design hydrograph, the incoming one, and this is the downstream hydrograph. So as you can realize, we have already solved this equation. So we are perfectly able to design rotation basin, both in the case in which the basin is deployed along the river or on one side of the river. So in this case it is simple. This is more or less a lake, as lake-like. So this is a kind of water body in which the dynamics can be neglected. Then we need to solve this one, which is the main difference. The main difference is here. We cannot use Q equal mu L 2G W minus zeta S power 3 because this is only true for a spillway without holes, just in this case. In this case, lower part. So here we have this one spillway, and here we have the lower part. So we cannot use only this one, only this part as we have done in past lectures, but we also need to use the water discharge that can flow in the under. In the lower part of the spillway, but from a conceptual point of view is exactly the same. We need again the stage storage curve, exactly as we have done in our last lectures. in past lectures. So the problem is not new for us. Is an application, a practical application of a method that we are able to use with very few difference, in particular related to this one. If we pay attention to the case in which the retention basin is deployed on one side of the river, you know this one, the incoming water discharge, and here we have the lateral spillway. Lateral spillway with known L. This is a hard topic, but we can solve it. We are able to solve this problem also when a structure is deployed downstream the lateral spillway. Of course, in the downstream part with respect to the lateral spillway, the normal flow does not occur because the flow here is influenced by this structure. But we are perfectly able to reconstruct the river profile from this point up this point, and then to reconstruct the water discharge that is flowing here, the Q2. And the Q2 changes with time. So for this basin, now we need to solve this problem. The Q2 is the inlet water discharge, but not the inlet water discharge along the river, but of this basin. So we need to solve the lateral spillway problem. The lateral spill problem is related to the water discharge that is conveyed to the basin. Then QI is actually the water discharge that is deviated to the basin. Then if Q4 is zero, actually we have that the volume of water within the water, the retention basin increases up to a certain level, and then we can also compute the free surface elevation within the basin. If the outlet works, then also this term can be must be taken into account. Then the tool is almost the same, the continuity equation, but used within a different framework. I mean within the framework of the dimensioning of the design of retention basin deployed on one side of the river. Then if I know this one, and this is statistical analysis again, statistical analysis, we are able in some way to reconstruct the water discharge that floods the retention basin, and then we can reconstruct the volume of water, and then this is the capacity of the retention basin. But also we can reconstruct the water discharge that, Q3, that is the water discharge that continue to flow. And then we have Q5, that is the water discharge if the outlet works are activated. So we can reconstruct all the configuration in terms of water discharge and verify if the maximum value of Q5 is compatible, just for example, with the urban area. So it is, of course, a complex design, but up to now, at least from a conceptual point of view, we are able to understand all the tools that we need to use. We are able to understand the physics behind these tools, and then we are perfectly able to understand the hydraulic behavior of this hydraulic structure that, again, I repeat, is aimed to decrease the maximum value of the water discharge flowing within a river, because, just for instance, it is not compatible with a kind of urban area. Just 1 minute and we finished, I switched to Italian. Quindi capite che può essere anche un po' complicato da un punto di vista pratico, ma capite anche che il dimensionamento, anche di dettaglio, di una, ad esempio, cassa di espansione in derivazione, se volete quella più complicata, sì, magari è complicato, però abbiamo tutti gli strumenti, sappiamo usare tutti gli strumenti che abbiamo visto fino a questo punto in questo corso. Infatti abbiamo la definizione della portata d'ingresso, analisi statistica, sfilatore laterale, abbiamo visto gli sfilatori laterali, forzati da una struttura messa a valle, ricostruzione dei profili di moto permanente, o se volete anche in moto a superficie, scusate, in moto vario a superficie libera. Quindi sappiamo calcolare Q1 con analisi statistica, Q3 per differenza con Q2 che sappiamo fare. Sulla cassa di espansione possiamo scrivere l'equazione di continuità che sappiamo risolvere. Abbiamo visto ad esempio il metodo di Vicutta. E la possiamo risolvere sia in assenza di portata in uscita, sia con una restituzione a valle. E quindi in questo caso siamo in grado di sapere qual è il volume massimo necessario a quella vasca di espansione. E ad esempio sapere anche qual è il livello all'interno della vasca, e quindi sappiamo riconoscere fino a quella Q5 a valle e verificare se è compatibile ad esempio con l'area urbana che stiamo difendendo progettando questa vasca di espansione in derivazione. Tutto questo per dirvi, per giustificare tutto lo sforzo che abbiamo dovuto fare nella prima parte del corso, perché tutto quello che stiamo vedendo adesso è semplicemente un'applicazione, non semplicemente, diciamo, è un'applicazione ad una serie di costruzioni idrauliche in cui la fisica ce la dovremmo avere ben chiara, perché abbiamo speso tanto tempo nella prima parte del corso. Abbiamo gli strumenti, perché li abbiamo visti nella prima parte del corso. Quello che ci stiamo aggiungendo adesso è, passatemi il termine, un po' di fantasia, un po' di buonsenso, perché sono sicuro che se uno avesse messo davanti al problema, va bene, io devo diminuire la portata, uno mi avrebbe proposto una soluzione, uno me ne avrebbe proposto un'altra, probabilmente qualcuno di voi mi avrebbe proposto questo. Detto questo, chiudiamo.